Good morning.
Good morning.
Happy Christmas. So I trivia this morning. Why do we say Merry Christmas? Anyone? So that's kind of true, because how weird would it be if we go Happy Christmas, Happy New Year? But realistically, it was an old Queen Elizabeth thing that she did not accept Merry Christmas. So she always said Happy Christmas and Merry New Year's, which means enjoyable. So have an enjoyable New Year. So trivia. So, all right. So pastor asked me to read out of Galatians chapter 4, and he said 4 or 5. And then he said, well, maybe you could do 1 through 5. But I don't like reading that well. So I'm going to read verses 3 through 5. And the reason why I think verse 3 is very good verse. So let's, if you have Galatians chapter 4, verses 3 through 5. And even so, we, when we were children, were in bondage under the elements of the world. But when the fullness of the time was come, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoptions of sons. Let's pray. Lord, again, we do come humbly before you as our Heavenly Father, our Lord, our Savior. And I try to comprehend it myself this day and what took forth over 2,000 years ago, and I just can't comprehend it. But Lord, I can thank you for sending your Son to be the Redeemer, to be the atonement, for I know my filthy sins that I commit each and every day. And not only mine, but to anyone that wants to call out upon his name and accept him as Lord and Savior. We thank you for that. I just thank you for this country we live in. I thank you that we can come into your house and worship you without fear of persecution. I do pray for our government officials, Lord. You've anointed them to be governors over us, but we need to pray for them. We pray most of all for their salvation, Lord, for the ones that don't know you. For the ones that are already in offices that do know you, Lord, we just pray that you would give them wisdom and boldness, and that they can be the salt and light that you would call them to be in their places of office. But Lord, you've given us each the ability to be the salt and light in our own little worlds. And I just pray that, again, throughout this upcoming new year, that if you tarry your coming, Lord, that you would just give us wisdom and boldness also to share the gospel to those around us that we come in contact with. Just give us the ability to do that. Lord, again, I just so thankful for this church body. I thank you for Pastor and Beth and how they serve. We look forward to Cameron and his family coming here just in the next few weeks. And we just pray that we can come in unity as a church and grow and become what you want us to be throughout this community, that we can serve in our own little Jerusalem. Lord, I just pray that this day, that as we probably gather later on today, many of us with family and friends, I just pray again that we remember what Christmas is all about, and that you came down from heaven's glory, knowing that after 30-some years, you'll go to the cross and die for us. And again, we thank you. Lord, I just, again, can't be in awe of all the blessings you give us. I know there's many hurting families here, though, whether it's emotional hurts, whether it's physical. Lord, just meet those needs. again, there's so many that I know that are hurting. And Lord, again, we just ask that your sovereign will be done to bring healing, whether it's physical or emotional. Just draw us each close to you throughout the day, throughout this week. And again, we look forward to serving you. We just pray and ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. You can be seated.
I have two quick announcements to make. One is that there are no services this Wednesday, this coming Wednesday. Oh, that's right. And the directory, the family directory, information is out in the lobby for that. So if you want to sign up for that, all right. Let's please stand. Ooh, bail me out, please, and sing our worship songs this morning.
Oh,
Thank you, and please be seated.
Amen. That was beautiful. Thank you. We are in Galatians chapter 4, and one day your Keurig is going to stop working. One day your new iPhone will need an upgrade. But what we're going to talk about this morning, the gifts that Jesus Christ gives, are the very best gifts available. I'm glad you could spend this Christmas morning and have a look at these timeless and eternal gifts that we're going to share with you in just a moment. But you know what? I've got to take a moment and just brag on God for a minute. Is that okay? If you've been where I've been the last 48 hours, seen the kind of things I've seen the last 48 hours, you would stop and you would give God thanks too. We left on Thursday from Chattanooga. We flew through Tennessee and we got to the Kentucky border. If you've ever been down I-75, you know that's a place called Jellicoe. And it's about 4.5 miles of just downhill, and then you get to the state of Kentucky. At the bottom of the hill, we started seeing traffic backed up for miles. So we thought, well, since traffic is going to be backed up, we might as well exit and get some gas. Glad we did. Because the interstate on I-75 was like an ice skating rink. And I don't understand how God does this or how these things work. Maybe you've asked yourself these questions, and if you know the answer, please tell me afterward, would you? How you can pray, how you can cry out to God, and you go right through, and there's not even a scratch on your car. The person next to you, they're just as godly. They love God too. Maybe they're crying out to God too, and maybe they're on the side of the road. But I want you to know we saw accident after accident after accident after accident. And I'm trying to figure out what's worse driving conditions. Is it the ice, where when you're at 40 miles an hour, 45, 50 miles, and you see that blinking light come on your dash that never comes on, and it means your wheels are spinning but you're not going anywhere and you feel totally helpless, out of control? Is that a worse condition, or is it the fog? I've been in fog too, and I don't know, if you slow down in fog, somebody's going to get you from behind. If you speed up in fog, you're going to get the guy in front of you. So I don't know which is worse. But I'll tell you this, my wife and I, she's so sweet during all this. I said, at times, we came to a complete stop right outside where the Ark is located. That's called Williamstown, Kentucky. There were 3 lanes of traffic, and it just came to a screeching halt. And we sat there for 45 minutes. It's starting to get dark. And my thought was, what if we have to stay here for hours? Well, the traffic began to flow again, and we made it through Cincinnati, through Dayton. Now it's dark. And the wind is picking up. My thermometer, I don't know if it goes below zero or not, but it stayed on zero. And I know the wind chill factor, do all that math, and it's like 32 degrees below zero if we were to get stuck. And we just saw car after car just happen. They spun out and hit the ditch, upside of a bank or whatever. And that very easily could have been us. So when we came down that little valley, it says the Little Miami River, you've been down that valley, it's about an hour south of here at regular speed. We came up the other side, and my wife and I, through this, she was quoting a lot of Psalms to me. And I'd say, honey, could you do another one for me, please? I need one right about now. And I think we memorized together Psalm 91, but that's a different issue. And I told her, I said, I don't know whether to stop or keep going. We wanted to get home to make sure our pipes wouldn't freeze. But when we came up that hill, I said, out of the valley, I said, I looked to my left, about my 10 o'clock position, there was a Hampton Inn at my 10 o'clock position. I said, and I didn't know, we going back and forth, should I stop, should we not stop? And I told her, I'm stopping here. If they have a place available, that's where we're spending the night. And I go into the front desk. It's about, I don't know, 9 o'clock at night, it seemed like. There was the nicest African-American young lady you'd ever want to meet. I'm sure she was a Christian, the way that she treated me. And I said, do you have just one more space available? I felt like the end where Jesus tried to find a place to stay overnight, you know, Mary and Joseph. And she said, we'll find a place for you. I said, oh, good. And I slept like a baby that night. Yeah, I felt like I had been in a boxing ring for 8 hours, you know. I mean, you're on high alert constantly. And so to sleep, I just really slept like a baby. But I got up early and my wife was still asleep, and I went down and had breakfast with the boys. You know, we were sharing war stories. Tell me the things you saw. You tell me what you saw. And well, we had some war stories going. Some of them may have been embellished. I don't know. Mine weren't, of course. But then we got back in the car, and this is the type of thing that you never want to see. It was about 8:15 in the morning. We left Sydney. We start going north, and if you know Sydney, you go around a curve, and then you're on an uphill small grade for about five miles. And I told my wife, I said, look up there. About a mile ahead, there was a semi-truck that had just jackknifed, and there was an SUV in the median. And they were taking a blanket and putting it over the SUV. It had just, the car had literally been decapitated. Another mile up the road, the same thing happened, and I got home and went on Google to find out if there were any fatalities, and all of us have been focused on the turnpike where there were four fatalities during that 50-car pileup. But if you were to Google the Shelby County news, you'd find there were three fatalities in that SUV that we saw. And the road was just littered. People were out picking up things off the road. And then I understand that they closed down the interstate. I was never so thankful to be home in all my life. If you prayed for us, I thank you. But I'm going to say it again. I don't know why the person next to me was prayed for and something happened to them. I don't understand how that works. I just want to thank the Lord this morning to be here in God's house. So I give him the glory for that. I wanted to start this morning with a rescue story. I put this up here for a reason, because when I got saved and I reached out by faith and received the gift of God, I honestly thought as a 17-year-old that, you know, I just put on salvation and that means I get to go to heaven when I die. And that's the end of it. I never realized that when you take the top off and you receive the gift of salvation, that's just the beginning. I mean, the gifts just keep on coming. So when it says the wages of sin is death, it goes on to say, however, but the gift of God is a quality of life. If you're here this morning without Jesus Christ, I want you to understand that eternal life is not just quantity, not just that direction, but it's a quality of life because it's a relationship with Jesus Christ. So let me just start with that. Now to my rescue story. A couple of weeks ago, I came across this. And the more I read over it and find out more information about it, I'm blown away by how some people can be rescued. Does anybody know Spanish, by the way? Anybody speak Spanish fluently? All right, well, you take my word for it then. That word is a Spanish word that means daring, appropriately labeled. The two men who left the southernmost tip of New Jersey, and they were just going to innocently take their time and go down the eastern seaboard all the way down to the southernmost tip of Florida. Along the Florida Keys, there's a little place called Yes, we do have someone who speaks Spanish fluently. Did you recognize that word? Okay. Tom, we're putting people on the spot way too much this morning. I think you started this whole thing, okay? So next time you do the reading of prayer, just read the scriptures, would you? I'm kidding. I love you, Tom. So these two guys are just making their way down the eastern seaboard, right? They get to a place called Camp Hatteras. Not Camp Hatteras, Cape Hatteras. The Outer Banks. And they claim that when they got there, the waters came together in such a way that they ran into mountainous waves. That's how one guy described it. This guy's one of them was 56, and the other is, 65, and the other one is 76. That's what it is. So they're up in years. But they get down to Cape Hatteras, and they find mountains of waves, they claimed. And they said that the wind was roaring, kind of like the winds that came through here recently. And as a result of that, they had their power knocked out, their navigational systems knocked out, and they were just left to drift out on the open waters. And this time of year, there's a strong current that will pull you slowly but surely northward into the icy North Atlantic Ocean. Now, when my wife and I sat there for 45 minutes the other day, I'm thinking to myself, are we ever going to get out of this mess? We could be here tonight and all day tomorrow. But at least we're on dry land. I mean, I could see a few houses. If I had to go knock on a door, I could get out of the car and do that, you know. But I tried to imagine, what would it be like to be adrift for 10 long days? Barely alive. And they look up, and they see coming in their direction a ship from Denmark. It's a tanker, actually. And now they're adrift off the shore of Delaware, like, what, 234 miles, somewhere in that ballpark. And this steamer, this huge tanker, is coming directly in their line of sight and vision. So they start waving their arms and flailing around. And the ship stops and picks them up, and it takes them safely to shore. I love those kinds of stories because, let me ask you something, who gets the credit for rescuing them? Did they do anything? And when we talk about salvation in Jesus Christ, and especially in the book of Galatians, it's this story that's on repeat over and over and over again. Take your hands off the glory of God. He is the one who saves, and Him alone. All you need do is to meet His criteria, which is repent of your sin, put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ and Him alone. He'll take it from there. He's the one who saves you. That's the point. So let me just give you an aerial view of the book of Galatians. Maybe it'll help us as we go through some of these verses in chapter 4, because we just jumped into the middle of it. You've heard the idea of palming a basketball. I could never really do a regular official-sized basketball. Wish I could. I would have been dangerous. But to palm a basketball means that you're confident with it. You understand it, and you can go places with it. And so what I want to do is just give you a quick overview of the book of Galatians and help you palm the book of Galatians before you leave this morning. And it basically boils down to three things. There are six chapters. In the first two chapters, it's all about Christ. It's my identity in Christ, who I am because of Christ. Chapter 2, verse 20, if you're there close by, look at chapter 2, verse 20, one of the key verses in the book of Galatians. I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but it's Christ who lives in me. And the life which I'm now living in the flesh, I'm living by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave Himself. My identity is in Christ and Christ alone. Chapters 3 and 4, my security is in Christ and Christ alone. And chapters 5 and 6, my community is in Christ and Christ alone. That's a broad brush of the book of Galatians. It's all about Jesus Christ, including your salvation. Please take your hands off the glory of God. He's the one that saves you. But when you study the book of Galatians on a little closer scale, you discover here was the problem in the church, which is a problem in churches today if you're not careful. Have you ever heard the term that sociologists use, extended adolescence? Adolescence used to be 10, 12, then it's 15, 20. There are some sociologists who claim that the adolescence age nowadays is up to 30, 35 years old. In other words, we've got a lot of boys trapped in a man's body. And there are a lot of people who are trying to get all the benefits and the privileges out of life without fulfilling their responsibilities. By the way, that's why people living together before marriage, extended adolescence. It was a problem in the church of Galatia. I mean, as an example, when we were down in Chattanooga, we were exchanging gifts. We bought some gifts for our grandson, who's about a year and a half. And one of them was a little Tykes basketball set. The other was a Hot Wheel racing car kit, that sort of a thing. But what if they had given that gift to me? I mean, what if I opened up a great big box and it said a little Tykes basketball set? I mean, I'm saying, duh, this doesn't seem to go together. Maybe they're saying indirectly, that fits your disposition. You're an adolescent still. I would have been grieved by that. Well, the problem in the church at Galatia is that they needed to grow up. They understood they were saved by grace through faith, plus nothing, minus nothing, but they had reverted into going back into their childish days of listing rules and regulations as a means of identifying how spiritual they were. And so what this passage is going to do, chapter 4, as best as I can understand it, the gifts that God gives us along the path to spiritual maturity. In other words, it's a diagnostic test of whether or not you know you're spiritually mature in Christ. Would it be okay if we just took that quiz this morning? Look with me at chapter 4, the verses that Tom read. In fact, I do like the first few verses. Let's start with verse 1. Chapter 4 says, "Now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, differs nothing from a servant, though he's Lord of all. But he's under tutors and governors until the time appointed of the Father. Even so, we, when we were children, we were in bondage under the elements of the world." Elements of the world. Don't miss that. We think that by keeping rules and regulations, we can be more spiritual. Notice what happens in verse 4. "When the fullness of time was come, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons." Number one, the first gift on this journey to spiritual maturity is the word redemption. You see it there in verse 4? When the fullness of time was come. That word fullness is the word pleroma. And it's the idea of a cup being completely filled to overflowing. And I want you to think about this. When God sent his Son, as someone mentioned earlier in the service this morning, it was at just the precise time. If you can look down in history on the world at this time, the Romans had their road systems going. They had their interstate systems. And Paul used that in the book of Acts to get the gospel to the uttermost parts of the earth. We praise God for that. The Greeks had their language going. That's when the Greek language was introduced, the Koine Greek language that we have in the New Testament. It is the most precise language known to man. And when all that came together, the fullness of time, God sent forth his Son. As a matter of fact, he uses time in anthropomorphic terms. The fullness of time had come. In other words, have you ever seen a woman who's pregnant? The first trimester something, the second trimester something. This is the fullness of time. This is a woman who's really, really pregnant. She can't even bend down and tie her shoes. She's so pregnant. That's what's going on here. Paul says, when the fullness, the pleroma of time came, God sent forth his Son, who was made of a woman, made under the law. Here's the reason why. To redeem them that are under the law. If you're here this morning, the first gift that God wants to give you is a relationship with himself. It's verse 5 where we see the word redeemed. And it's the word ex agorazo, which means literally to go into a slave market and to purchase a slave, buy that slave, and take it home. There was a true story that came out of the Civil War era where a very wealthy landowner went into a slave market and he purchased a slave. And when he brought the slave home, he took the papers of that slave, gave it to the slave, and said, "Look, you're a free man. You can go." And the man grabbed his small belongings, and he shot off like a dart. And as he's running, it dawns on him, wait a minute. I don't have anywhere to go. I don't have any place to stay. I don't know what to do. He turned around and he ran back to his master and he told him those three things. I don't know where I'm going. I don't know what to do. I have no place to stay. Would you mind if I stayed with you? And this is what the landowner said under one condition. that from here on out, you serve me out of freedom and no longer out of fear. You know, that's what Jesus Christ did for me. He went into a slave market where I was held in captivity and bondage to my sin. And he paid the price, the ultimate price, by dying on the cross, shedding his blood so that I might go free. And he says, here are your papers. You can go. And when I looked up on that cross and saw what he did on my behalf, dawned on me, I have no place I want to go other than Jesus. And nothing else I want to do rather than serving Jesus. I turned around and I bolted back to him. And I said, sir, if you don't mind, I'd love to serve you for the rest of my life. That's gift number one. He redeemed us. The tragedy, and this is the whole overview of the book of Galatians, is that there are people who get saved and they want to go back to keeping Sabbath in the context. Today's language, we would say something like maybe giving to the offering plate, attending church, reading my Bible, praying. And all those things are wonderful in and of themselves. But the tragedy of legalism is that you can love rules and regulations and not have a relationship with Jesus Christ. Question this morning, do you have a relationship with Jesus Christ? If you're there this morning sitting and you're thinking, well, let's see, I try to keep the law. Did you know, first of all, you can't keep the law? Keeping the law is like asking a four-year-old to dunk a basketball. Can a four-year-old dunk a basketball? Not on a regular-sized gym. Here's a guy who's going to try it. Now watch what he does. First of all, he cheats. And secondly, watch what happens after he thinks he's dunked the basketball. Here we go. Bang. Now, this is what the law does. Okay? Bang. You think you keep the law? I had to fit that in somewhere. What's the purpose of the law? Back in chapter 3, if you want to look back there for just a moment, it says, the law is our schoolmaster, and it brings us to Christ so that we might be justified by faith. What's the schoolmaster? It's a tutor. It's a teacher. Rules and regulations. And you realize, I can't do this. I can't keep the law. So it brings us to Christ, and the law is designed is never to save anybody. And please understand, there's nothing wrong with the law, the moral law of God, the Ten Commandments. Romans 7:12 says that the law is holy. It goes on to say the commandment is holy, just, and good. But the law is a mirror, James says, the stepbrother of Christ, a mirror that when you look into it, you realize there's no way I can keep the law. And it points away to the cross of Jesus Christ, and you realize that in Jesus Christ, that's the only way you can keep the law. So the law is a schoolmaster that leads me to Christ. What happens next? After faith has come, we're no longer under a schoolmaster. Because we become children of God by faith in Jesus Christ. So please, let's not miss the point this morning. If we open up the first gift on the path to maturity, what we're going to discover is that you need to make sure that you're genuinely born again this morning. Does that make sense? That's one of those gifts that never gets old, that you never have to turn in the gift, you don't have to upgrade it. I'm redeemed by the grace of God. Number two, look with me in the next couple of verses here in Galatians chapter 4. Verse 5 says, he's redeemed us that were under the law that we might receive the adoption of sons. And by the way, we could go there this morning. Adoption means I'm set into a family and I'm able to enjoy all the benefits instantly. I don't have to wait till I get turned 21 or that sort of a thing. Verse 6, the next gift that God wants to give you this morning is the gift of assurance of your salvation. How many of you, in the quietness of your heart, right there where you're sitting, can honestly say that I know without a shadow of a doubt that I'm saved? I'm so thankful the pastor that led me to the Lord at 17 years of age took time to go over Romans chapter 8. Basically, it develops what's in verse 6 here. So let's read verse 6. And because your sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of His Son into your hearts, krazo is the Greek word, crying, crying, and notice what he's crying. The Aramaic word Abba is translated in English, Father. All right? How do you know you're saved this morning? One of the primary ways that I know I'm saved is the moment I repented of my sin, put my faith and trust in Jesus Christ and Him alone, something happened to me that never happened before. There was a spirit that God dropped into my spirit, and they cooperated with each other. They testified, the book of Romans says, with each other, that there's new life inside of you. I begin to cry out, Abba, Father, and that simply means I need you and I love you and I want a relationship with you. So how do you know you're saved this morning? Galatians chapter 4, verse 6. Because your sons, God sent forth the Spirit of His Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. Do you have that kind of relationship with the Lord this morning? You've not received the spirit of bondage again to fear. This is the one over Romans chapter 8. This is the one the pastor shared with me. You've received the spirit of adoption, whereby we're crying, Abba, Father. And the Spirit is bearing witness, testifying jointly with our spirits that we're the children of God. It's so easy to try to get your identity in rules and in regulations. And you strut if you're keeping the rules and regulations, and you wallow if you're not keeping them. But when I come to the book of Galatians, Paul doesn't approach it that way. He says the way that we're to walk when I'm newly wired in Christ, when I'm born again, is to know that I'm redeemed and to know that I have this assurance deep down in the basement of my heart. It's a love relationship. Now, I don't know how you did it, but let me just sort of rewind back to my college days for a few minutes. When I was in college, I was working like 40 hours a week plus. And then I enjoyed that so much, I thought I'll stay another 3 years and go through seminary that way. And the point I'm trying to make is that every single moment of my calendar was called for. And there was not too much margin for me to play around, which I wouldn't take anything for that nowadays. Kept me out of a lot of trouble. And I was the type of person, you know, you think to yourself, if I ever start dating someone, she's not going to interrupt any of my schedule, because my schedule is devoted to study, work, whatever I need to do to get the job done. But then Miss Beth showed up on my radar, right? And I took her home one night. And she says, can't you just stay 5 minutes longer? Okay, 5 minutes. And we walk inside, we sit at the fireplace, and we just have a nice chat. I said, well, okay, it's time to go now. And she says, can't you just stay 10 minutes longer? No, just 10 minutes. I said, okay, let's talk. 9 minutes left. You know how that goes. And slowly but surely, she wore me down. You want to know why? Because slowly but surely, I was giving her my heart. See, what God wants to do, He wants to change your behavior. There's no question about that. But He says, the way we're going to do this is I'm going to get to your behavior through your heart. And if you love me, really love me, then there's nothing in your life that you're not willing to give up, or your schedule that you're willing to rearrange, not if God gets your heart. That's really what's going on here. I'm redeemed. Number two, I have this reassurance. God put His love deep down in my heart. How many of you have done this? Now, I am not too computer savvy. So one day we got internet at our house, and you call Spectrum, and you ask them to walk it through. And I was doing everything Spectrum was asking me to do. It wasn't working. And so I call them up. Anybody know what this is? This is a modem or a router. I've had to learn that the hard way. And I'm plugging all these things in, and the lady on the other end of the phone says, well, do you have a modem? And I said, a what? You know, a router. I had to look up in a dictionary what a modem and a router actually was and what they do. They actually convert signals from data, digital rather, to analog or radio waves. And that's where you get your internet. Not to be outdone, I heard one guy who said he put up his dish TV and plugged in all the right connections, and he had to call up dish TV, and they said, oh, do you have the dish? He said, the what? The dish. You know, some satellite out there somewhere is giving off signals. And when you get the dish hooked up, those signals bounce back to the satellite. Do you know that's what's going on deep in the basement of the heart of a child of God who's on the path to spiritual maturity? They know they're redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ and that alone. And they know that God's Spirit is welling up deep within them. And when they start going to places that they shouldn't go, and let's face it, even if you're in the middle of things you shouldn't be doing, there's something screaming inside of you. Don't do that. You love God too much to do that. God has sent forth the Spirit of His Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. Whatever has your heart has your affection. We could take a pop quiz right here, right now. Everybody, take out your checkbook, and I know where your heart is if I start seeing where your money flows. That's where your heart is. And Jesus said that. Where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Remember that? If I took your day timer, your calendar, where do you spend the majority of your time? That's what you truly love. God is more concerned about your heart than your behavior. That's what this passage is about. That's why, personally, I'm blown away by a guy who takes up so much of the Old Testament storyline. His name is David. The guy that broke all the rules, murderer, adulterer, you name it. But God called him a man after my own heart. Because if you were to read Psalm 51, when he got in trouble, he didn't ask God to help him have more rules and regulations. Remember what he said? God created me a clean heart and renew a right spirit within me. And that's consistent with a true child of God. That's what God wants from you this morning. The first gift on the path to spiritual maturity is to know that you're redeemed. Is to have this embedded reassurance of the Holy Spirit crying out from deep within, Abba, Father. But when I come to this next paragraph, believe me, I've had to read over it and over and over and try to crunch the numbers here. What in the world are you getting at, Paul, in verses 8 through 21? And as best as I can understand it, the Apostle Paul says, if someone is really mature in Jesus Christ, and then they really aren't concerned with what you think about them. If God knows all about me, and He does, and God still cares about me, and He does, then why should I be bent out of shape whether you like me or not? For example, look at verse 11. He says, man, some translations say, I'm perplexed. My translation says, I'm afraid of you. I've done all these things for you Galatian believers. I bestowed upon you labor in vain. Look down at verse 15. Where's the blessedness you spake of? For I bear record of you that if it had been possible, you would have plucked your own eyes out and given them to me. Let me try to put in perspective what I think Paul is getting at down through here. You remember when Paul was in the church at Antioch, which is right up here north of Jerusalem, way up, well north of Jerusalem. This is in the book of Acts when the church was hitting on all eight cylinders. I mean, it was at its zenith. And the church looked out among them to see who can we send out to do missionary service. And they picked out two brothers who were red hot on fire for God. Paul and Barnabas and John Mark went through this little bitty island. Do you see it there in the middle of the Mediterranean called Cyprus? When they got down there to Paphos, there was this demon-possessed man, and Paul dealt with him. And I'm thinking to myself, man, John Mark is in the background watching all of this. And then they get on a ship, and they go up to, where is it, Perga? somewhere there along the shore, and John Mark just says, this is how things are going to be. I'm going back to Mama. Paul and Barnabas continue on their missionary journey, and when they get to a place called Lystra, this is where Timothy is from. This is where we believe the Apostle Paul was stoned nearly, if not to death. And if you know anything about stoning, what they do is they take you out to a 30-foot ledge, and they push you off. And if you survive that, they'll pick up boulders and they'll finish off the job. Paul probably had a concussion when he fell off that 30-foot drop. No doubt Paul was mangled, he was beaten, he was bloodied, and part of what affected him for the rest of his life were his eyes. I mean, just read it to you there. Verse 15. When I first showed up, you would have plucked out your own eyes and you would have given them to me. Look over at chapter 6, it's verse 11, I believe. It says, you see how large a letter I've written unto you with mine own hand. I believe personally this is where Paul cried out to God and said, God, I've got this thorn in the flesh. I've got poor eyesight. Is there any way you could take it away? And three times God said, no, Paul, but I'll give you more grace to deal with it. But the point I'm trying to make, when Paul first shows up on the scene, I mean, these people treated him like an angel. They would be willing to pluck their own eyes out for him. But then Paul kept telling them the truth and telling them the truth and telling them the truth. And instead of receiving the truth, they start pointing to the Apostle Paul and say, we don't like the way you said it. You just split your infinitives. You know, the Greeks in Paul's day and the Romans in Paul's day, they wanted things to be polished, their presentations, their oratorical ability. And Paul went on record and said, look, when I came upon among you, I mean, I was weak, I was lowly. I mean, I didn't try to hide or cover anything up. You saw my eyesight. You saw my speech. And some people say that Paul was short, probably was. But yet, through all of this, the Apostle Paul is wanting us to understand in this next paragraph is, listen, if you accept me, that's fine. But if you don't accept me, I want you to know, I live because of Christ. I get my identity through Jesus Christ. My security comes from Christ, not man's approval. Boy, I've been there and done that, right? 17, when I got saved. My only regret, I wish I would have been saved earlier. I wish I would have gone to class and sat on the front row and studied and burned the midnight oil, prepared. But you know, Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 that God chooses the weak things of the world to confound the mighty, and the foolish things of the world to confound those who are wise. And the base things and the despised things God uses so that no man might touch the glory of God. How are we doing in our diagnostic test along the path to spiritual maturity? Are you sure this morning that you're redeemed? Are you sure this morning that you have that indwelling Holy Spirit that's crying out deep from within, Abba, Father, I love you. I've messed up again this morning, Father. I want to please you. I want to love you. That's the second step. And the third step is you've grown to the place where you're not diverted because of what people think of you. You just stay steady serving the Lord Jesus Christ. When I first got saved, I used to get every book that Charles Swindoll would write. I used to push record on my little recorder and listen to his sermons and run home and listen to them when I had a break. I mean, Charles Swindoll was one of my mentors. He really cut my teeth on him. I remember as a young Christian reading one of his books where he took that fairy tale of the Velveteen Rabbit. Remember that story? And he developed from a Christian perspective, where evidently the Velveteen Rabbit got into a conversation with one of the other toys that was given for Christmas. And the horse asks the rabbit a question. The rabbit asks the horse a question. And the rabbit asks the horse, how do you know when you're really real? And Velveteen Rabbit said, well, it may take years, but one day your eye will be rubbed off, toy rabbit. One day your hair will be rubbed off. One day you'll get really, 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 really old. And you may not look good, but the person who's rubbed off the eyes and all the hair and everything else will really, really love you, and everybody else may just misunderstand. How about you this morning? Do you care what other people think about you, or do you ultimately care what God thinks about you? There's a passage, I believe, in chapter 1, Paul says, do I try to please you or God? Do I seek to please men? If I please men, I should not be the servant of Jesus Christ. This is the last one that I see here, and it's the closing paragraph. And again, it's an analogy. Paul refers to that. And you got to read it over and over and say to yourself, what in the world is Paul wanting us to take away this morning? Number one, I'm redeemed. Number two, I'm reassured. Number three, I have real living in Christ, in Christ alone. But number four and finally, you know, God's designed this whole Christian life so that I must be relying upon Him. It's kind of like getting in your car and you survived one ice skating rink experience and your reward, you've still got 300 more miles to go. I find that's my journey home to heaven, right? Where I must constantly, moment by moment by moment by moment, cry out to God and look over at my wife and say, honey, would you read another psalm to me? Let's pray together. Let's cry out to God together. And that's the Christian life. And what Paul does here in this closing Old Testament story, he reaches back, you see verse 22 where he talks about Abraham. It is written that Abraham had two sons, one by a bondmaid, that was Hagar, that became Ishmael, the other by a free woman. But he was of the bondwoman, was born after the flesh. Don't miss that. You see that in verses 22 and 23? That means human ability. What's on display here are two different abilities. Abraham was called to follow God at 75 years old. He was told he would have a son. 14 years later, there's no son. He thought he'd take matters into his own hands and have the child through his handmaid. That's a mistake. That's a big-time mistake. There's been nothing but difficulties between the Palestinians and the Israelis ever since. And it's illustrative of what we do with the law. If God asks us to follow Him, He's going to fulfill His promises through us. When we get into the middle of the journey, we take matters in our own hands, we roll up our sleeves and do it our way, we're heading for trouble. That's the point. I must be reliant upon the Lord Jesus Christ from the moment I ask Him for salvation until the moment I take my last breath. But just like I rode into Arlington yesterday morning, I was never more pleased to ride into Arlington than yesterday morning. I know this journey for me, it's been 45 years from one ice patch to the next on my journey home. One day this heart's going to stop beating and I'm going to collapse into the arms of Jesus and there's going to be an eternal rest. What's the book of Galatians about? Number one, I am a desperately needy person. I was humbled last couple of days. I mean, when you ask your wife, please quote another psalm to me, that's pretty humbling. And I'm desperately needy. Number two, I'm completely helpless. Lord, I need you. Every moment I need you. But finally, I'm totally embraced by a loving God. I told you last week I would share this with you, and I've been going over it again and again and again because I love this story. About a medical doctor from Scotland who grew up in a godly home and he made several advances in the medical community. And he said, when I was a kid, I saw something that changed my life. I'll never forget it. I'll never forget driving by that car a couple days ago and watching them put a blanket over the passenger side of it. James Simpson said that when he was a kid, he saw a guy tied to a cart and he was drugged through the streets and they beat him and they beat him and they beat him unmercifully. And he asked the question, is anyone willing to take his place? He asked another question, why this kind of punishment? And he discovered it was for a small infraction. But that was the start of his spiritual experience. He said he went off to college. And for whatever reason, once again, he saw a man blindfolded. And in those days, they would hang you for the smallest infraction. And he said that someone had stolen a small parcel from a stagecoach. And they put the blindfold around him and they hung him. And he said, wasn't anybody willing to take his place? Why did he have to suffer like that for a small infraction? But then he said, one day I looked away to the cross and I realized that Jesus did take my place. Not for a petty crime that comes and goes, but because of my sin against his holiness, he died on that cross for me. And that was the turning point in his life where he was redeemed. He had that Holy Spirit deep within crying out, Abba, Father. He became genuine, real in the face of opposition and scorn. He was real. He was genuine. And he said one day he went to church. And the pastor preached a sermon from Isaiah 53. He said, a little girl ran up to him afterward and said, would you come see my daddy in the hospital? I know you've been there many times, but would you come one more time and share the gospel with him? And he heard the pastor say to that little girl, okay, I'll go. And he found out later that pastor went to the side of her dad and said, you know what, I've shared with you everything I can share with everything I know about the gospel of Jesus Christ. Tell you what I'm going to do. I'm just going to read the passage that we had in church today. He turned to Isaiah 53 and he started reading. He was bruised for our transgressions. And the man stopped him and he said, that's all I need to hear. Someone died in my place so that I won't have to die and suffer for all of eternity without Christ. And the man gave himself to Jesus Christ. As we close this morning, what about you? Have you received the first gift, the major gift, redemption? Do you really have reassurance deep in your heart? Are you real? I mean, really real? Or are you blown about by what everybody thinks about you? And finally, are you genuinely reliant on the Lord? 24/7, 365. These are gifts that God gives his children along the path to maturity. Let's bow our heads, shall we? If our heads bowed, our eyes are closed. Let me just reinforce this morning. I'm really concerned there may be somebody here who doesn't know Christ as their Lord and Savior. And you came out on a very chilly, chilly Sunday morning. And every time I'm in these conditions, oftentimes, it reminds me of how Charles Spurgeon came to know Christ, one of the greatest pastors England ever had. Went to church when it was sub-zero temperatures in England. The pastor couldn't even make it that morning, but some layman got up and read from the book of Isaiah, look unto me and be ye saved, all ye ends of the earth, for I am God, there is no other. And all that layman knew how to do was just keep repeating it, and repeating it, and repeating it. And finally, Charles Spurgeon did that. He looked away to Jesus. And if you're here this morning, you've never repented of your sin, never realized that Christ died on that cross for you, won't you let him redeem you this morning? Won't you repent of your sin and say yes to the claims of Jesus Christ and begin to follow him? If you'd like to do that, I'm going to be here at the front. Would like to talk to you about it. If you're here as a believer and God has been speaking to your heart in other areas, ask him to help you grow up on this pathway to maturity. He'll give you these gifts along the way. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for your grace. Help us now to go out and live like it to this lost and dying world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand together and close by singing Amazing Grace.
Amazing grace.
Said.
Amen.
Has it been good to you this holiday season? All right, I'm going to pray that he takes us all home safely. Maybe we should stay home this afternoon, okay? Stay home. Well, let's pray. Father, I just can't get over your goodness to us. Wherever we turn in Scripture, we are reminded over and over and over again of just how much you truly love us. And again, you didn't just tell us you love us, but you went to the cross. You sent your son, your finest gift, that he might shed his life's blood, that we would know the cleansing and forgiveness of sin. So please, Lord, help us to live in light of these gifts today and help us to be a spokesman for Jesus Christ in this coming week. Use us to make an impact in Arlington, Hancock County, the state of Ohio, and throughout the world as we seek to follow you. Again, thank you for sending your son. In Jesus' name, amen.